Thank you, God. You know, something special that Carolyn and I have done for, gosh, I don't know how many years, probably 10 or 12 years, is over across the Chester Bridge and going up into the bluffs, there's four or five German Lutheran settlements. And they came up the river in 1839, and they, of course, crossed from Germany, come in at New Orleans, come up the river, and purchased all that property over in that area. And so they've been there since 1839. And what they do every year at Christmas, they open up all of these old Lutheran churches. And they're decorated, and one of the churches had the largest tree I believe I've ever seen inside a building. How they got it in there was but it is so neat. But what's that? 20 feet tall, the Christmas tree, a cedar tree. But those old churches are so neat. But one of the things, that the reason I wanted to share this with you, one of the churches I went in, and something God really spoke to my heart, something I'd like to pass on to you. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, or whatever you're about, God is always with you. And God never leaves you. He never forsakes you. And so I was standing in that old Lutheran church, and I thought, God, I love you. I adore you. And what a privilege in knowing you. And I want you to know he literally consumed me at that point. And so there I stood with tears streaming down my cheeks thinking, well, thank you, God, that you love us so much. And, you know, it's just a little reminder for Carolyn and I that, you know, something we've done now for several years. And, of course, Ann and Larry went with us this time. And I always laugh because one of the things about going through all those old churches, the Germans have the best food. And they have all these old German sausages, and every church has their own thing set out. And of course, an interesting thing, and then we'll receive our tithes and offering. The Presbyterian came before the German Lutherans. And so they had been there 30 years and had their settlement. The Germans come up through, and none of them were farmers. They were all business-type people that came. And they almost starved to death. They didn't know how to survive in that type of climate. And so the Presbyterian took all the German Lutheran in, and they fed them that first year and took care of them and gave of their resources to help save their life. Isn't that a pretty good story? And, you know, not only that, the Presbyterian church that was there first was divided between the north and the south. And so they had balconies on each side. The slaves got to sit on one side, and the people for the union sat on the other side. And what's neat, in them balconies are hand carvings where the slaves sat. And Carolyn, nobody really knows the history, but we kind of think maybe they were special carvings that they was pointing to the freedom, and what they call that, the Underground Railroad. So we asked about that. But isn't that interesting? Right here in our backyard, you have a wonderful piece of history. And not only that, but a really neat way, if you want to get into the Christmas spirit of going through and touring them old churches and seeing the decorations and some unbelievable nativity scenes. And, of course, Anne, her nativity scene, one of the churches had the same nativity characters in it. So that was pretty neat. So, anyway, just a little piece of enjoyment we had this week after we finished Christmas caroling in the park. And Larry. I didn't hear him. You know, yes, you have to go to try all this. Everybody thinks I go because of food, but really, I do go because it's a special time of the season, all right? Charlie, you're on. Dave, can you help Charlie? Well, you pray for him, okay? both of your characters, I think, you know. Amen. Let's join together in prayer. Charlie, would you lead us?
Lord, we just come this time of year. We just lift you up and praise you for the sacrifice you made for us. And, Lord, you're always here for us. At that time, being there with us through good times. And,
Yes, brother.
And Lord, we just pray that we can keep in mind the true meaning of this season. It's not a lot of celebration of you. It is celebrating you.
Yes, yes.
And Lord, as we offer you, just pray that you give us the wisdom. Use your money wisely for the church, the lighthouse in which we feel it.
Yes. Amen. Thank you, Charlie.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. And joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare in a room, and heaven and nature sing. And heaven and
a couple things. One, this Wednesday is movie night, and it's going to be the Christmas manger. We're going to do pizza and cookies, because we have cookies. So we'll do that and keep that in mind. And, of course, you can bring other kind of neat things around cookies. And we'll do the Christmas manger, and so keep that in mind. Of course, Monday night's the men's prayer meeting, and we'll share that together. If you notice the 25th, no Wednesday night service, or January the 1st, because both of those fall on Christmas and New Year's. Any other announcements that we need to share with one another? Okay. This is the third week of Advent, and Ann had asked me last night, she said, what is the title of your message? And I said, well, really, I just put Advent Joy. And I want you to think about that, because Advent just means coming. And aren't you glad God so loved the world that he sent his Son to come into this world to be a gift to all who will believe on him? You know, the scripture in Isaiah 40 in verse 3 says, a voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the wilderness a highway for our God.
Yes.
And, you know, John the Baptist, he came proclaiming that message.
Yes.
And it was a message to Israel to prepare the way for their king was coming. The sad part of that story is they missed their king. Yes. They did not receive him as their king. It says he came to his own, and his own received him not. But, you know, throughout history, we celebrate these Advent services. And Advent means coming. But how many realize the joy, he's coming again.
Yeah.
But this time he's not coming as a babe in a manger. He's coming as the King of Kings and
amen,
the Lord of Lords.
Amen, amen, amen.
And, you know, as we go through these Advent services, we need to make preparation in our heart that we are anticipating his coming again, that we're excited about his coming. You know, isn't it amazing that even in our difficult world that we live in, and maybe our frustrations and our anxiety and sometimes getting overwhelmed trying to get ready for Christmas, but aren't you glad that God is with us? And even in the midst of our frustrations, he's there to be a very help to us. Amen? And, you know, as we go through this Advent season and we talk about all of these different things, how many realize that the joy of the Lord becomes our strength? And we ought to have joy unbelievable and full of glory in looking at how much God loves us.
Amen?
Amen? And, you know, we need to fix our heart on God's love. And we need to anticipate how much he loves. Aren't you, and let me just put this footnote, aren't you glad that he comes even in some of your most difficult times?
Yes.
Aren't you glad that even when you're so frustrated, he still loves you and he'll still come? And no matter where you are, guys, or no matter what you're going through, if you'll look to him and cry out and just say, God, I need you, guess what he'll do? He'll show up on the scene. Amen? So let's join together in prayer and The guys has got a song for us, and we're going to light the third Advent candle. But let's ask God to prepare our hearts to receive His word this morning. Amen. Father, we come in the name of Jesus. And Father, we thank You for this special time of the season. We thank You that it's a reminder of how much You love us. And Father, I pray that You'll open our hearts and minds this morning to receive Your word, that Father will receive it with excitement and joy and expectation of You working powerfully in and through our lives. So Father, speak to our hearts. Use the word and the working of Your Holy Spirit to touch our lives. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Okay, guys.
His holy name, Christ.
Thank you, guys. How many times have you asked, are you ready for Christmas? Or been asked? Well, isn't it amazing that all the things we think we need to do and all the gifts we think we need to buy and all the presents and all of that and all the anxiety and that it creates within us. But, you know, this morning I want to ask you, are you ready for the Advent? Are you ready for His return? You know, we think we have to have everything just right to make Christmas just right for our families. But, you know, this morning as I share with you that you need to ponder in your heart, what can you do to be ready for the Lord's return? What can you do to be ready for you to experience Christ within your life? You know, when you think about it, that if we ask God, how many of you believe God hears us? And if we cry out to Him, He has an ear always tuned to us. And we can cry out to Him and He will help us and He will touch our lives. And so as we go through this message, I want you, let's just stop a moment. And I want you to ask God to give you ears to hear. I'm going to share some truths about making preparation for the coming of the King. I'm going to share some truth with you that will help you live victorious every day of your life. How many of you believe we can be victorious in the Lord? I really believe that. And you know, I want us to pray and just ask God to give us ears to hear, a heart to respond, and that we'll allow God's Word to come alive in us and have an impact on our lives. So let's just pray a minute. Father, we paused to acknowledge You. We pause to ask that You would open our ears and our heart, our mind, that we could receive from You, that we could receive the truth of Your Word, that it would have impact on our lives, it would transform our lives, that You would touch us and bring joy unspeakable and full of glory into our lives and into this Christmas season. And I thank You for it in Jesus' name. You know, one of the interesting things, I introduced last Sunday about positional truth, that there are certain truths that will never change. And, you know, I shared with you that you are born into a family, and you're either born male or female, and those are positional truths. They never change. You know, I'm a right. I'll always be a right. I inherited certain characteristics from my family. And they had an impact on my life. But I want you to understand that there is positional truths in the Bible that reveal that you can be born again, and it changes you from being in the first Adam to being in the second Adam. And who is the second Adam? Jesus. He is the Christ. And the first Adam was an Adam of sin and death. The second Adam, who was Christ Jesus, is a life-giving spirit, and He gives you Zoe life. You ever heard Zoe? It is the life of God, and He gives that to you as a gift when you believe on Him and you open your heart up, and it changes your positional truth. Now, you're no longer in the first Adam, but guess what? You're in the second Adam. Amen? And you take on His characteristics. You take on His nature and His likeness. And these are truths that you need to know and understand and allow them to impact your life. Do you realize when you get born again that inside you, you're a new creation? The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, old things have passed away, and guess what? Behold, all things become new. You're a new creation in Christ Jesus. But here's what I want you to think with me in the next few minutes that I share with you. Inside Charlie, as a born-again believer, is a Spirit of God that lives inside of him. And you know what? I was working on this, and you know what? That Spirit of God inside is crying to be released, crying to renew you on the outside, because the renewal, the transformation takes place on the inside of you. And I want you to think about this. Charlie will never be any more righteous in the eyes of God than what he is right now. Charlie on the inside has been made justified in the sight of God. Charlie has been made a new person on the inside. But how many of you realize that there is positional truth and he's in Christ? That'll never change. He'll never be any more righteous than what he was the day he received Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. He'll never be any more righteous when he goes to heaven than he was the day that Jesus came into his heart and transformed his life and made him a life-experiencing, life-giving spirit. Now, I want you to think about that. We'll talk about that a little bit more. But that is positional truth. That is the truth that you're born again, that you're a new creation, that your sins have been forgiven, and you receive the gift of righteousness. It's not your works of righteousness. And here's the trouble with Christianity today. We have got over onto the side that we want to work out everything. But you see, that Spirit of God that lives in Charlie or lives in anybody who's a believer is crying, let me out. Let me out. Let me out. Let me live through you. Because, you know, Paul made this statement in Romans 7. You need to read Romans 7, but then don't stop there. Read Romans 8, because it is the Spirit of life that gave him the victory. But Paul said, oh, miserable person I am. Oh, wretched man that I am. The things I know I should do, I don't. And the things that I know I shouldn't do, I find my flesh doing that. And then he cries out, who shall deliver me from this body of flesh? And then he moves into Romans 8. And he said, it's the Spirit of life that will deliver me and give me the victory. And so as we go through these messages and we talk about having the joy of the Lord, we talk about having the love of the Lord, we talk about all of these, having these blessed hopes, I want you to understand there's truths that I want you to pick up with me and be able to apply them to your life. You know, because it does not depend on what you have done in your salvation, but on what God has done. You cannot work into heaven. You cannot do works of righteousness and expect to go to heaven. How many realize this Christmas story is a story that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son to come into this world? You know, and he's more than a baby in a manger. He lived 33 years of his life, destined to go to the cross of Calvary because he was going to pay the penalty of the sins of mankind. And he paid that price. And by faith, through grace, we receive the gift of eternal life. And at that moment, we are justified of our sins. We are set free of the bondage of sin. No longer does the law of sin and death have an effect on us. But here's where the battle. You know where the battle is? Right here. The battle is in your mind. And that's why it's so important. It says you'll know the truth, and the truth will do what? It'll set you free. But you see, the interesting thing is that you need to know the truth. These positional truths, which will never change, you need to learn them. You need to allow them to get into your heart and mind. And you know what? When it gets in your heart and mind, guess what? It'll start changing your outside. But here's what I've always said, and you need to understand this. It's to me, is one of the most profound things that you can ponder in your heart and mind. What's inside of you will come out when you get squeezed in life. What's inside of you will affect how you act, how you talk, how you behave. All of these ingredients. And you see, when you get squeezed in life, and boy, Christmas time, isn't it amazing how we can get squeezed in life at Christmas time? You know, I have to tell you part of my story. The Black Friday experience with me only went one time, and I've never went since. And I never will go, probably, because I was recovering from back surgery. And me and my son-in-law went, and they had it wrapped around the building to get in. And when they opened the doors and said, come on in, it looked like a stampede of Jerry's cattle. I'm telling you. And there was a lady behind me. Have you ever got one of those shopping carts that the wheels out, and they go boom, 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 and you go down? Well, here I was walking, and I could hear this wheel going boom, 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 and it was getting closer. And I knew she was going to hit me in the rear end. And I knew I was pretty handicapped because I was recovering from surgery, and I was going as fast as I could. And I got to this glass case. It was a T, and I had to make a right or the left or go to the glass case. So I went to the glass case, and she hit me in the rear end and knocked me over that glass case. Now I'm laying with my head down under the case with my feet dangling up in the air. And you know, the only good thing out of that, the one thing I stood in line for all of that, when I was laying with my head down there, there was a caseload of them in that case. I'm telling you, I've never went since, and I never will go again. I was very thankful that I got it was a special camera that the kids just had to have. Isn't it amazing what kind of circumstances we get in? You know, but listen to Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 7. It says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. That's why I want you to learn these positional truths, that God will begin to renew your thinking and help you realize you are positioned in Christ. When you read the New Testament, you ought to read and look for in whom or in Christ the benefits and the resources that we have in Christ, because we are in a new position. We are children of God. We have Christ in us, and that's our hope of glory. Amen? And so these are important things that I want you to pick up with me as we talk about all of these different things. And this positional truth revolves around grace. Think about it. It revolves around the grace of God. Aren't you glad that God's a gracious God? Aren't you glad that God demonstrated his grace to us, that he sent his son to die on the cross? You see, our decision, our choice is that we believe that, and we receive that by faith. It says, by faith through grace, you're what? You're saved. And as you open your heart up and invite Christ in, then here's the neat things. Listen to what it says. Take your Bible and turn to Romans chapter 5, verse 17 through 21. Let me read this to you. I want you to listen to this. I may stop and emphasize a phrase as we go through this. But starting with verse 17, it says, for if by one man's offense, death reigned through the one. Okay, talking about the first Adam. Death reigned through Adam. Adam and Eve were told by God, don't eat of the tree. The devil came along with his deception, made it appealing to the flesh, appealing to the eye, and they gave in and they ate of that tree. Okay? And God says, the moment you eat of that tree, you'll die. Guess what? Death started reigning in Adam and Eve. And because of that offense, death is reigned in all creation. Every living being born into this world had the effect of that first Adam. So when you read here, it simply says, for by one man's offense, death reigned through the one. Much more, those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ, in him, through Christ, of whom all these are important facts, that you reign in life. Now, if you think about reigning in life, what's that kind of speak to you? Instead of being under the circumstance, could you be on top of it? Instead of being bogged down with doubts and fears and all of these different things, you can reign in life because of your position in Christ, because you're a child of God. You have the benefits and the resources of heaven. Okay, so you can reign in Christ, and I'm going to talk to you a minute about a woodshed thinking, and you think about that for a moment. But verse 18, it says, therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation, even so, through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men. Isn't that pretty heavy? All men have an opportunity to choose and believe, all people in Christ. For as by one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience, many will be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounds, grace abounds much more. So that as sin reigned in death, even so grace might reign through the righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, can you imagine? Here is a positional truth that God says he'll give you the gift of righteousness. How many realize that you don't have to earn that gift? You don't have to try to work that gift up. You don't have to try to do 20 acts of kindness to receive it. It is a free gift of righteousness that through Jesus Christ, His shedding His blood on the cross of Calvary, that your sins have been paid for. Isn't that pretty cool? And you receive that gift of righteousness, and it's a marvelous part of God's grace. And through that grace, as you develop these positional truths, and you know the truths, and you allow that, when you're talking about knowing the truth, it's not just reading the Bible. You know, I think everybody ought to read the Bible. How many agree with that? But it's asking God's Holy Spirit to make it known to your heart and mind, to make it come alive in you that you realize. You know, I've always said it this way, that you should get impregnated with the Word of God, that it begins to produce within you a faith that you can be a victorious person on the inside and on the outside. Isn't that pretty cool? And that, you know, here's a crazy thing about it. This woodshed kind of thinking. When I was growing up, if I got in trouble, it was a woodshed experience. And do you know that even though I knew I'd get a woodshed experience, I was a stinker. I was always getting in trouble. I was always doing something that was not right. Matter of fact, one time, of course, I tell you how old I am and the way things change. I went to a little country school called Baku School. Charlie Nevels, who was the road commissioner, was the principal, and he taught 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. When you got in trouble, you had to go to his class, and he would punish you in front of the 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. And Charlie had a paddle that had a crack in it. And he would hit you sometimes, and you'd get pinched with the crack. So Charlie, kind man that he was, gave you a choice if you got in trouble. You understand, I know a lot about this because I experienced it. And you could go out and you could cut a switch or you could choose the paddle. So I was in trouble. And Charlie asked me what I liked, and I said, I'll cut my own switch. So I went out and I found an old rotten stick. And I delicately carried it in, so proud of my thinking, handed it to Charlie, and he grabbed it. And when he grabbed it, he picked it up and it crumbled in about 6 pieces. Guess what I got? I got the paddle with the crack in it. Now, the woodshed thinking is, I grew up thinking, I can't hardly do anything. I'm going to get in trouble. Yeah. And, you know, I got this attitude of thinking, wow, I'm a failure. I'm a reject. I can't overcome. All of these things. But how many people live with that woodshed mentality? That I'm a failure. I can't do anything right. You know, the older I get, I almost have to battle that quite a bit. Me and Carolyn major in being late anymore. Matter of fact, we was late for the Christmas party, and we were in such a hurry that Carolyn made a cherry cheesecake. We got there without the cherries. Cherry cheesecake without cherries is not very rewarding. Guess what we're going to have tonight? We're going to get the cherries out of the refrigerator to have cherry cheesecake. But when you think about the woodshed mentality, you know, the devil would like to come along and say you're a failure. You can never overcome. You can't get over this situation. But I want you to know there's positional truth that says you can be an overcomer. Amen. The Bible says I can do all things through Christ who what? Strengthens me. Who renews within me this new way of living. Amen. I used to love the little song that we sang. We don't ever sing it anymore. But I found a new way of living. I found life divine. I found peace and I found healing. I found all of these things that gave me a new way of living. Isn't that pretty cool? And I want you to discover them with me as we talk about these new way of living. Because you see, you've been set free from the law of sin and death. You know what? It's a terrible way to try to live by the law because the law says act right or else. I always got the else with old Charlie. You know, it's amazing. I ended up being the pastor of some of his offspring. You know, but grace says you are the righteousness of God. And here's the key that I want you to understand. You're the righteousness of God. Start acting like it. Start allowing God to renew your mind, that battle of the will up here. Because your mind is your emotions. Your mind is your will. Your mind does the thinking. But you see, that Spirit of God that is made right in right relationship with God is wanting to renew your thinking according to these positional truths, that you will start acting it out, because the other thing is called the experiential truth. And you know what? It's based off of your senses. It's based off of your feeling. It's based off of your thinking. And so for you to have a change on the outward, you need to allow the Word of God to come alive in you and start renewing your thinking. You know, it says, let this mind be in you that was what? In Christ Jesus. Let the renewing of your mind, is what Ephesians says. And so the only way that renewing of the mind is that you search out these positional truths and you read them and you meditate upon them. And you know what? The Bible says He sent the Holy Spirit to be a helper, to help guide you in the truth, to help make known the truths of God that will change your way of living. And so you know the truth. And you know, it says faith comes by what? And hearing what? The Word of God. All of these scriptures are lined up that will come from the inside through the working of the Holy Spirit that begins to renew your mind. And that's why I said it's getting impregnated with the Word of God, because it wants to come out of you. It wants to affect. And when you get squeezed, instead of being angry, you demonstrate love. When you get in frustrating situations, instead of being impatient and saying something that you shouldn't have said, you have patience ruling in your mind and in your heart and in your actions. And the list goes on. And as you experience, you know, Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it how? More abundantly. How many really, where sin abounds, how much more does the grace of God abound? In other words, there's an abundance of resources that are available to us that helps us live what's inside on the outside as we experience what God wants to do within our lives. Think about this. Here's Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 23 and 24. And be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that you put on the new man. How many realize we're talking about new creation here? You put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. As you allow God to change your life. Now, I want you to think about this. I wrote these scriptures down, and I want you to listen to them a moment. In Matthew, the seventh chapter. There's a parable of the sower. Does anybody remember without looking what the sower was sowing? Huh? He was sowing seed, but what was the seed he was sowing? The Word of God. Okay. And when you read this, it's Mark chapter 4. We're going to do Matthew chapter 7 in a minute. Mark chapter 4, and starting with verse 20, listen to what it says. But these are the ones sown on the good ground. Those who hear the word, accept it, and bear fruit, some 30-fold, some 60-fold, and some 100-fold. How many realize there's choices here? But I want you to understand something. And here's the challenge. Inside of you is living the life of God. Inside of you is a new man, a spirit man. Because how many realize your spirit, soul, and body, you're a triune person, just like God is a triune God. And when you get saved, your spirit is renewed. You become a new man on the inside. You become a new creation of God. And it's all on the inside. But he says the seed is sown, and you have a choice. If you see there was a difference in scale, there was 30, 60, and 100-fold return. You look at Christianity today, and I can break it down. There's some 1%ers, and there's some 10%ers, and there's some 20%ers. And there is some 100%ers, but it revolves around your choice. You choose whether you're going to diligently seek the Word of God. You choose whether you're going to spend quiet time with God. You choose whether you're going to invest and say, wow, I want to learn positional truths that will release the life of God, that will affect my thinking and affect my actions and the way I live my life. I told Jerry, in my frustration, I hope that we don't have to go to a location for the rapture. We'll miss it. Huh? What? Yeah, because if if it's going to have ice today, we can't go to the rapture. Yeah, that's my frustration. You know, we find all kind of excuses not to go to church. We find all kind of, I'm too busy to have a quiet time. I'm too busy, or, you know, I've got all these other things I've got to do. But let me tell you, the most important choice is that you choose to say, well, I want to receive the word. I want to be in a preparation that God's word will fall on the good ground of my heart, and it's going to produce results in my life. One of the greatest things that ever happened to me when I got saved, well, that was unbelievable. And God literally transformed my life. I went from being an alcoholic and just a real pain in the rear end to most people to being a born-again child of God. And it changed my life. It had an impact. But along with that, Fred Bishop, I really want Fred, if I can persuade him, to come and speak at our church sometime. Because Freddie has been my mentor for all my Christianity. And Freddie has just been not only my mentor, but he became my best friend. And Freddie knows that if he needs me, all it takes is a call. Or if I need him, he'll drop everything he's doing to come to help us. But what Freddie did, he shared with me the importance of learning the Word of God. He shared with me the importance of meditating on that Word and allowing that Word to get a hold of me and start impacting my life. And it's been so bad. He taught me the importance of having quiet time. How many realize it's difficult to have quiet time the way we live? I mean, how many realize, you know, you grandmas, it's difficult because you are built-in babysitters. You know, I'm the, you know, what do they call that, the mother that travels the kids all over, chauffeur. Yeah, but don't they have another word for it? Huh? What is it? Soccer mom. I'm the soccer dad. Soccer grandpa is what I am. I was at the ball game Friday night. Heat of the game, guys. And my granddaughter says, Papa, wasn't you supposed to take me home at halftime? I said, uh-uh. you're going to find you another ride. But before I really got myself in trouble, she said, that's all right. My friends and I, we're going to go celebrate something at the Dairy Queen. Then I thought, well, maybe I ought to go too, you know. But see, you're busy with life. But you need to make sure you take some time aside and have a quiet time. You know, let me tell you a simple little prayer I'd recommend for you. Simple little prayer, what I've been doing. God, let me see you today. Let me hear you today. Let me encounter you today. And you know what? Those are simple little words, but I'm going to tell you what, it's been amazing. It was just like standing in that old Lutheran church, and all of a sudden I just sensed the presence of God. And there for just a few moments, it was a special moment between me and God. But how many realize if you determine to set quiet time aside and say, God, I just need to be still. Still my heart. Still my mind. Just calm me down a little bit. And guys, I said something to somebody the other day. I said, you know, it's kind of hard for me to sit still. And they said, really? I didn't know how I wanted to handle that. It is. I mean, when I'm sitting, I'm moving. Have you ever felt that way? My mind, I told Carolyn when I retired from pastoring full time, I said, you know, I don't want to really think about anything for a while. She said, that'll never happen. I said, I'd just like to rest my mind where I'm not trying to think of something, plan something, or do something. It just don't happen. I'm wired the wrong way. But when it comes to quiet time, guys, it is so important that you take that quiet time. You know, it doesn't have to be a whole lot of amount of time. It can be just a small amount. But what I think you'll find, if you'll do that, you'll hunger for more, and you'll want more. And you'll move from 30 to 60, and you'll move from 60 to 100. And all of a sudden, you'll realize, hey, I don't talk like I used to talk. I don't get frustrated like I used to get frustrated. I don't respond like I used to respond. And you see, it's simply that God's Spirit is renewing your mind. And he's taking you on a journey of faith. And what he's doing, he's going to open through these positional truths this abundant grace that begins to abound in your life. And it begins to make you a better wife or husband. It begins to make you a better neighbor. It begins to make you a better person. And when you get squeezed, God comes out. Isn't that pretty cool? That's a good way of living, isn't it? Are you interested in learning these positional truths and learning what God wants to do in your life and learning to realize that He wants to release that spirit inside of you and cause you to be that new creation on the outside? You know what? It says that the sower, when it fell on the good ground, it bore 30, 60, and 100-fold fruit. It was very fruitful. How many of you like to have a little fruit of love, a little fruit of joy, a little fruit of peace, a little fruit of faithfulness, a little fruit of kindness? All of those are available. And guess what? They're right down inside that spirit man. And they're wanting to come out of you. And they're wanting to impact your life. And so we're going to learn these positional truths together. And we're going to allow God to work powerfully, powerfully in our lives and allow Him to change our life. You know, here's the interesting thing. And I want you to see this, and I'll close. In 1 Corinthians 15, starting with verse 45, it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. God breathed into him, and he became a living being. The last Adam, meaning Christ, became a life-giving spirit. Now think about this. The first, verse 47, the first man was of the earth, made of the dust, but the second man is of the Lord from heaven. And verse 48 says, as was the man of dust, also are those who are made of the dust, as is in the heavenly man, so also are those who are of the heavenly, being born again of Jesus, being in Him, okay? And we have become the image of Him, bearing the image of the heavenly man. Do you realize our responsibility is to be a reflection of Him? Our responsibility is to experience this life-giving spirit that transforms you on the inside, and as you allow it to renew your mind, you become a life-giving spirit. You know, I told Carolyn, I said, it's so neat sometimes how God makes divine appointments. How many of you believe He makes divine appointments? I went in to get a Diet Coke when we was coming home the other night. There was a black lady that was the clerk. And she was very helpful because I had my change there and I didn't see a dime. So she wanted 23 cents and I said, well, I don't have 23 cents because I only saw one dime. I saw the pennies. And she tucked my hand. She said, here, let me help you. And I thought, okay. And she pulls the other dime out and the three pennies and had 23 cents. And she said, see, that wasn't bad. And I thought, no, I just couldn't really see that other dime. But anyway, in the middle of that, I said, well, wait a minute. I got something for you in light of that. And I reached in my pocket and I said, here, you can have this penny. And there's something about if you do much witnessing on the streets and sharing much of Christ, black people have a tender heart towards God. I mean, I've done it all over the world, and it's amazing how God will touch the black community. And so I gave her that penny, and she looked at it, and she was overwhelmed. She said, I've never seen anything like that. And I said, well, there's a message about that, and on the back of the penny is the 1 cent. And I said, this is Christmas time, but this is the message that God loved you. And he said, it grabbed a hold of that lady. And just in about a 3-minute exchange, I was able to share Christ with her. That's all it was, about a 3-minute exchange. But God touched her heart. And God began to grab a hold of her life. And she thanked me as I was going out the door. She said, I've never heard that or never saw that. Isn't that pretty cool? But you see, God wants us to be a life-giving spirit. That as we go through life, and God's transforming us, we can, in exchange, give life to people. You know, this has been one of the best tools. Dave, how many thousands of these have you passed out? A bunch. You know, Wow, she turned her witness on you. Huh? That's pretty cool. You know, And so I want you to think about it. What do I need to do to be ready for Advent? What do I need to do in my life to be able to be a life-giving spirit, to be able to share life with people that you come in contact? And guys, these little pennies is just one way. There's many, many different ways of doing something for somebody. We've been, I don't know where you read in the book, we do acts of kindness once a month in our church. And it's amazing how God brought something up. Every time we turn around, each month there's a special act of kindness. And the church board, we worked on that, and God's really blessed that. And it's just another way of saying, hey, we want to share the love of God with you. We want you to encounter a God that can have an impact on your life. So let's stand together this morning. And as you stand with me, just bow your heads a moment. Close your eyes. As you pause just for a moment, just ask God to help you focus on the real meaning of Christmas. Ask God to help you focus on becoming that new man on the outside as you are on the inside. Allow God to create a hunger and a thirst for His Word. And ask God to cause the Word to come alive to you, to become real to you. Wow. And if you need forgiveness, says He's faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. All you have to do is ask Him and say, God, forgive me. Forgive me for missing the mark. Forgive me for not allowing You to renew my life. I want us to pray together. And let's ask God to make this Christmas season the most meaningful Christmas season that you've ever encountered. Ask God to use you. And more than anything, it's great to give the gifts, but this ask God to help us give the gift of life to the people we come in contact with. Father, we come in the name of Jesus. And Father, we ask You to forgive us of our sins. We ask You to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And Father, I pray that You'll create in us a hunger and a thirst for Your Word. Cause Your Word to come alive in us. And Father, may it come alive and may it transform and renew our minds and our wills and our thinking. And I thank You for that, Father. And I thank You for our little church here. And Father, I pray that You'll help us have an impact on our community, our neighbors. And that, Father God, that we'll be ambassadors of light, bearers of truth. And I thank You for it. And so, Father, touch our lives as only You can. Work powerfully in them. And we just receive Your marvelous grace. And may that grace through this Christmas season abound in and through our lives. And we thank You for it. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, turn around and hug somebody around you. Tell them you love them in Jesus.
Come, let earth receive her King. And joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare in a room, and heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ. Joy to the earth.